Good evening, and welcome to our special presentation of Tony's Market Club. I'm Tina Hosley, the Director of Operations for TonyTurner.com. I will facilitate today's session along with Annette Helsper, our Market Research Technician, and Tony Turner will be our presenter. Please take a couple of moments now to read our disclaimer slide. We are pleased to present tonight's special session of Tony's Market Club, presented by Tony Turner. Tony is the best-selling author of A Beginner's Guide to Day Trading Online, 2nd Edition, A Beginner's Guide to Short-Term Trading, 2nd Edition, and Short-Term Trading in the New Stock Market. She's also the co-author, along with Gordon Scott, of their most recent book, Invest to Win. Tony is a popular educator and sought-after speaker in the financial arena. She speaks regularly at trading forums and conferences across the United States, including college campuses, traders expos, and money shows. Tonight, we will do an example of a typical Market Club session. During the Market Club, Tony covers a question of the week, a market overview, mini trading lesson, 5 trading ideas for stocks and ETFs, a review of open trades, followed by a question and answer session. So with that, let's get started. I'm going to turn the microphone over to Tony so that we can begin tonight's session. Thanks so much.
Hello, everybody. This is Tony Turner. Thank you for that, Tina. I really appreciate that introduction. And I guess I could make a quick announcement here. I just found out that my second book, A Beginner's Guide to Short-Term Trading, 2nd Edition, is now going to be translated into Russian. So we're very gratified about that. Let's get started here. What we're going to do is a quick explanation of Tony's Market Club and give you guys, I hope you're going to learn from something from this session. I always, always want to educate no matter what I'm saying or how I'm saying it in this webinar. I hope you'll take something away from it, even if you don't look at Tony's Market Club as something you want to do. On the screen, you'll see an example of a typical Market Club session. And I should tell you, now is fine, Tina. Excuse me, guys. Now is fine. I should tell you that Tony's Market Club began, I opened it in March of 2009. So it's been in existence now for 8 years. And as we did yesterday's session, I believe that was session number 414. And believe it or not, I actually have people in Tony's Market Club. We have members who have been with us since those first days. So I'd like to welcome everybody tonight. And I would also like to say thank you because I see some of those members even with us today or tonight in some places, and I'm so gratified. We have a fantastic, fantastic group of people from every level, from beginners on up to intermediate, and probably a few very experienced, accomplished traders. I can tell by the questions people ask, sort of where they are in their journey, in their experience in trading, and we do have all levels, of course. It does help if you know how to read a basic price chart. That really is something you'd need to be able to do probably before you get into Tony's Market Club and can take advantage of it. Now, back to the current slide. In Tony's Market Club, every Monday from 4:30 to 6 p.m. Eastern, we go through a session that is outlined like this. First, we have the question of the week, and I'm going to talk about the question of the week in just a minute. But basically, the question of a week is probably the single most important thing that we talk about and that we learn in Tony's Market Club, because the question of the week is your mental and emotional approach to the market. And I can absolutely tell you that from all of the years and the thousands of people I've taught, people from all over the world, that it is your mental and emotional mindset, how you approach the market that will pretty much determine your success. We can all get a lot of monitors. We can all learn how to read basic price charts. We can all understand the basics of the market to a degree. But if you don't have the mindset that you need to be successful, then you've got a problem. And so the first thing we always do in Tony's Market Club is we spend 5 to 10 minutes on the question of the week. And I'll talk about that more in a minute. The next step we take is the market overview. And this is what you need to know about the market, the general overall mood and manner of the market to make good decisions. You don't, when you're an investor, investors tend to be bottoms up, we call them, bottoms up kind of approach, because they don't, or the investors don't care so much usually what's going on in the market when they enter it. They have a company, hopefully they've researched that company or their stockbroker has, and it's like, I'm going to buy Apple today, and maybe they don't know where the market is or what it's doing or where it might go. It's just like, today I'm going to buy Apple, or today I'm going to buy NextEra Energy or whatever the equity or ETF is. Traders, however, we have a top-down approach. A top-down approach means that we look at the major indices. We look at the entire market. We say, what is the market feeling like today? And just as you wouldn't pack up your car and with a picnic and put the kids in the back and head off to the park for a picnic, you wouldn't do that on a really extremely rainy, thundering day. You want to look outside and see what the weather is like before you move off to go to a picnic. In the same way, we want to look at the mood and manner of the market to determine what mood it's in before we enter a trade, because it has a very big impact on which way our trades go. So after the question of the week, we do the market overview. Then we talk about open trades that we have. And boy, do we have a bunch. I'll talk about Thursday update a little later on. But I can tell you that we probably have, and everybody won't have the same amount or the same things, but I'm sure we have at least 20 open trades going at any given time. And so I go over in each session a review of some of our open trades, definitely the trades that we looked at the week before to open, and then any other trades that are going on right now that our members want to look at. After that, I present a mini trading lesson. And once in a while, and I know our members know this, once in a while I get caught up with these mini trading lessons and I go a few minutes longer than I mean to. But I think it's so important for you all to know what to do when you're in the market, when you're in the heat of battle. And I think the mini trading lesson can be a very important aspect of that trading. After all, you can't be in the market club all day. I'm not sitting next to you all day. And learning more about trading in the market is of supreme importance. Finally, the last next to the last segment we do is our trading ideas. And I present our members with 5, sometimes 6 trading ideas, 3 long and 2 short. And then I throw in an extra long trade most of the time, and they are called Vegas trades. And a Vegas trade, I call it Vegas because it's kind of like, I'm going to say you're gambling unless you go in and do your homework. If I go through probably 400 or 500 charts of stocks before I recommend any for trading ideas. And as I'm going through these stocks, anything from large caps to small caps, to tech stocks, to telecom, to utilities, to retail, anything you can think of, wherever I think there's a good place to look, I fly through these indexes very, very quickly. And sometimes I'll trip over a chart, and usually it's a low price stock. Maybe it's $3, $4, $5 stock. I'll trip over these. I don't have time to research them. Maybe I've noticed that they have a negative price to earnings ratio. Maybe they have kind of crummy fundamentals. but I'll offer it up as a Vegas trade. And when it's a Vegas trade, I show it to you and I say, hey, you are on your own. We're not going to tell you every step to take with this. And we have one stop that is in place, one stop strategy. It's very, very simple. And the funny thing is, a lot of times our Vegas trades have taken off and turned into real screamers. And we do have a definite strategy of trading them, but I haven't done the research on their fundamentals like I do for our other trading ideas. So that is what we do with our trading ideas. Sometimes I'll give you an exchange traded fund. Most of the time it's stocks. And when it comes to these, and I'll talk about this a little more in our current trading ideas, I'm going to show you the three trading ideas, the three long trading ideas that I talked about yesterday. So you're going to have these to look at and perhaps even trade if you want to in just a few minutes. So let's go on now to our next slide. First of all, I want to talk a little bit about here. I do want to talk about the question of the week and the reason, and just for a couple of minutes, the reason that I call our market psychology, or as they call it these days, behavioral finance, the reason that we do this again is that it is the single most important part of your market approach, is your mental and emotional approach to the market. As I said before, this will determine your success. I remember, oh gosh, back in the early days of my trading, and I'm going to say it was right around the year 2000, and yes, I've been doing it even longer than that. And I remember a gentleman that was a brilliant trader. His trades were so big, as we call them, he could move the market. And when I say move the market, back then we used to look at level two screens and we could see trades going off. And some of you have never done that and some of you have. But if you have watched level two screens, you'll know that if you do that, you can see trades, each trade going off. And you'll see trades that are block trades that are maybe so big in share size that they'll actually move the particular market up, or the stock up a little bit. Or down. And this guy I'm talking about was such a credible trader. He could actually move Microsoft, and it takes a heck of a lot of money to move Microsoft. It's sad to say he was a fantastic, or still is a fantastic person, a very savvy trader, but his mindset was not right, so he sabotaged himself and eventually ended up, as smart as he was, blowing up his whole account, as we call it. And a really cool guy, and it's only because his approach, his mental, emotional approach to the market, whatever it was, wasn't what it should have been. So that's why I say, come on, people, look at how you're approaching the market. Now, I call it the question of the week, because Anthony Robbins has a very sage saying, I believe, and I'm paraphrasing here when I say, he says that the quality of your questions determines the quality of your life. The quality of your questions determines the quality of your life. And so we can ask our questions ourselves questions each morning in a general sense. I can say to myself when I wake up, and many times do, how can I make this the most enjoyable day ever? How can I make this the most productive day ever? What two things can I do today that will raise my trading profits? So that's why we ask questions of the week. Our questions of the week in Tony's Market Club, they present questions and then we talk about their answers, and you'll think of more on your own. They are designed to give you the mindset you need to approach the market successfully. And that mindset is calm confidence. You are calm in your approach to the market because We know that when we are fearful, we go to a place in our brain that has very, very limited options. It's a scientific thing. It's not some woo-woo thing. I'm working with a neuroscientist. It's scientifically proven that when you get scared or fearful or anxious, your thoughts fall down into your brain and move into a part of your brain called the amygdala, where you have very limited options. However, if you remain calm, if you remain calm, your thoughts stay up right behind your forehead in the part of your brain in your prefrontal cortex that makes your executive decisions and the best decisions. So we want to stay calm and we want to stay confident. That mindset leads to trading success. And what we are confident is our ability to make the best decisions and the calmest decisions and the right decisions no matter what happens in the market. So, okay, recent questions, I'll just tell you now before we go on, recent questions that we've had in Tony's Market Club. A couple of weeks ago, we did, during the trading day, am I constantly striving for excellence? Am I constantly striving for excellence? So if you put that at your elbow when you're trading, it kind of holds you responsible to not make decisions that can take you in the wrong direction, like ignoring your stop or jumping into a trade when maybe you shouldn't be, and you know that, but you did it anyway, or you're going to do it anyway. Am I constantly striving for excellence? Am I reading? Am I learning? Am I calm? Am I striving for excellence in everything I do? A next question that we had a few weeks ago, what trading patterns do I have that limit my success, and how can I eliminate them from my trading day? And some of those, I'm sure you all can think of some. I have some that fortunately I don't do so much anymore, but that's because I've worked really hard to get rid of my negative patterns. But maybe there are some patterns like maybe you tend to chase trades. You hear on TV, somebody says on CNBC or Bloomberg, this stock is the best thing since sliced bread, and you look at it and it's going up and you yell woohoo and you buy 100 shares or 1,000 shares without any kind of research or planning. That's a pattern that doesn't always do well. Maybe you ignore stops, and we all want to ignore our stops. There's standing room only in that room. We all want to. But I named a bunch of different patterns in this segment. What about revenge trades? What about revenge trades? That's when you make maybe one or two or three or four or more losing trades. And then to get back at the market for taking your money, you put on a great big volatile trade with all the money you can muster and say, there, I'll get the market back. I'll get my money back and I'll fix that market. And we all know what revenge is. Revenge is like drinking poison and waiting for the other guy to die. The market isn't going to die, fortunately. So we don't want to do revenge trades either, because we usually make poor decisions when we do them. And the final one we talked about yesterday was, do I grade my trades and adjust my risk accordingly? So we talked about grading our trades, giving our trades an A, a B, or a C. And I think that is a fantastic way when you start to get into a trade, or even right after you're into it. Maybe you look at your trades and you say it's an A trade if you have done your research, if you are hopefully trading in the direction of the market, unless you're on purpose not doing that. Hopefully you know where that stock sector is and what it's doing. Hopefully you've got a really good entry. Hopefully you know where your protective stop is and your profit target is. Those three numbers are absolute necessities. And make sure that your risk reward is in a good place, either 1 to 2, one part risk and two parts reward, or one part risk and three parts potential reward. So if you do all of that, you could give your trade an A. If you just a B would be, say you just glanced at the trade, you're pretty decent traders, you know how to get in and out. You glanced in it, you read part of an article, you yelled woohoo, and you jumped into the trade. You said, I can put my stop here. So you didn't really, really, really get into it before you did it. You didn't study it the night before, the morning before the closing opening bell. You just jumped in. You sort of kind of know. That would be a B trade. A C trade maybe would be, again, maybe a talking head on TV said something, or your dentist said, buy this stock, it's really going to be a winner, or the taxi driver or whoever, and you didn't look and you jumped in. And as one of our members yesterday said, that would even be an incomplete and needs more work labeled by most teachers. So grade your trades. Again, it holds you to a level of responsibility. And when I say adjust my risk accordingly, if you know you're getting into, when you get in the habit of doing this and you say, hey, this is a C trade, then if it's a mistake and you realize it, fix your mistakes fast in trading. Fix them very fast. Either jump back out of the trade and take a small loss maybe because of slippage in commissions, or hopefully if you're jumping into a C trade and you realize that, you adjust your risk by making the share size very, very small, and immediately, please, please, please put a hard stop in with your broker. All right, so the question of the week is a very important part of Tony's Market Club. I've given you a quick overview of it. Now, speaking of overviews, let's go on to the market overview, and I'll give you a quick rundown of today. What you see on your chart here is the S&P 500 index itself. And we know that today the NASDAQ composite made a new high. Of course, the QQQs made a new high. We know the market is truly in bullish mode here. What I'm hoping is that it stays in bullish mode here. When I captured this chart today at 2390, and I don't like this cursor very much. I wonder if there's something else we could use. When I captured this chart today, well, I don't like that very much. But anyway, the S&P 500 was trading at 2390. Its prior high on March the 1st right here was at 2400 and change. Now, why do we follow the S&P 500, especially in our market overview? The first thing we look at is either the S&P 500, a daily chart like this one, or the S&P 500 SPDR, the ETF, because of course that has volume on it. Why do we follow this benchmark index? We do it because in bull markets, 3 out of 5 stocks will follow the S&P 500 higher. In bear markets or down markets, 4 out of 5 stocks will follow the S&P 500 lower. So if there's such a thing as a crystal ball, the S&P 500 would be that crystal ball. We can see now that it's positive and moving higher, and just so. Many, many, many of the stocks in our major indexes are doing the same thing. Now, you'll always see a sector or two that's moving lower. I believe that oil was still moving and energy stocks were still moving lower today. However, I was spending time on this webinar and didn't really study the market today except for Tony's Market Club positions. So you're going to see some that move lower. A lot of them moved higher right now. The market is really in a bullish mode. My question is to the market, okay, I know the NASDAQ is flying higher, and I didn't put all that up because we don't have time, and I'm glad. I'm also glad that the Russell 2000 Small Cap Index is making new highs today. And I'm glad because you might want to bring this up on your charts, and you can do so by putting up the IWM, which is the iShares Russell 2000 ETF. It can act as a leading indicator for the markets. The IWM, if it stays strong, the small caps, it can act as a leading indicator for the market. And today it was very strong, and I'm glad for that. As I usually say, now I can exhale. As long as it stays above its 50-day moving average. But let's go back to the S&P 500. On this daily chart, the red line on this screen is the 20-day simple moving average. The green line on this screen is the 50-day simple moving average, and the black line on this screen is the simple 200-day moving average. Now, these are moving averages I use on my indexes. I use the 200-day and the 50-day because they are major moving averages, of course, that the institutional people use. The institutional guys pay attention to these. So if they do it, I do it. And of course, the 20-day moving average is also a good short-term, kind of a short-term indicator. So we can say then that if a stock is moving above its 20-day moving average, In the short term, it's obviously strong. May not be in the long term, but in the short term. Why is 20 days so important? I don't know how many of you ever thought about this, but because there are about 20 to 21 days in each month, trading days in each month. So that's one reason we use this moving average. Now, the 50-day moving average, of course, can act as an intermediate-term trend indicator. And we can say in the intermediate term, and certainly right now, the S&P 500 is in an uptrend. The 200-day moving average is our long-term trend line. And, of course, since there are about 240 to 250 trading days in the year, if our stock or index is trading above this line, then we know it's in pretty positive territory. Now, the S&P 500, again, is in a bullish mode. These three big gaps worry me a little because I think that there was some short covering taking place right here. And it's okay, but those aren't short covering is when the shorts are buying back their positions. They're covering their positions. And so I'll be interested to see. I know the NASDAQ is flying higher, and goodness knows it should. We've got to watch this coming Thursday night, because on Thursday night, on Thursday night, coming out with earnings, I believe it's Intel, Microsoft, Google, Amazon, and Baidu, and that's a big darn deal. So Thursday night, we will see, hopefully higher, where the NASDAQ Composite and the NASDAQ 100 is on Friday morning. This is the biggest week in our earnings session for the first Q1 earnings. And so Thursday night is going to be a very big deal, especially for techs. Okay, so keep an eye on the S&P 500. We're bullish right now. I'll be interested to see what happens when and if it hits the 2400 line again. Can it rise over it? Does it have the strength to do so? If there are short sellers up here lurking, will they have the power to move it down? Will buyers say, hey, this is as good as it gets and sell? Or will this thing get legs again and move into another new uptrend? And hey, bull markets are always a heck of a lot more fun than bear markets. So let's keep hope the positivity keeps going here, at least through the end of earnings season. Now, our next chart is, I'm going to show you a review of one of our recent trades. And we've had, as I said, we have a bunch of them. This one was a simple one to make. Now, I want to tell you right now that in Tony's Market Club, we use a setup that I developed back in 2009. And I worked and worked and came up with a setup that we use in Tony's Market Club. The moving averages are different than these moving averages. We're sticking here with our 20, 50, and 200 day. The Sleeping Tiger setup is the setup that we use for most of our trades in Tony's Market Club. Now, most of our trades our swing trades, but if you use the stops I give you, and a lot of times if you use the Thursday update stops, which you'll catch on to if you join Tony's Market Club, and which of course you'll get, we've been known to stay in trades for 3, 4, 5 months at a time. Now, why is that advantageous? It's advantageous because, and believe me, people, I wrote a book on day trading. I wrote the second edition back in the year in 1997, 1998, when I moved to New York. I was in a trading room with a bunch of guys. I sometimes made 200 trades a day. So I know what it's like. That's what we did back then. We pounded out trades in this room with two teachers walking around, sometimes hundreds of trades a day. I know what it's like to day trade. I supported myself doing it. However, the bid-ask spread has narrowed quite a bit, and for other reasons I won't go into, I believe day traders still can make a whole lot of money and do very well, but in Tony's Market Club, we've taken on this methodology of swing trading. I like it because of this reason. Look, the longer you can stay in a trade or a position and it is meeting your criteria for a successful trade, the more money you are going to make, because hopping in and out of trades too much costs you money. It costs you slippage if you don't get in right where you wanted to, or if you don't get out right where you wanted to. That's called slippage. And it costs you commissions, which even in this day and age can add up. So the longer you can stay in a trade that is doing well, that is doing what you've established as your rules, and in Tony's Market Club, we have very definite rules. As long as it's doing what we want it to do, we are in. At the moment it decides it's not going to cooperate anymore and it's going to break our rules, we take our profits. So in that way, again, we can stay in our trades for, sometimes we stay in a few days, sometimes you can day trade the first 1 or 2 days of the entry I give you. Or if you wish, you can do, and sometimes I plan longer term trades, because sometimes the long term trades that bring in 10, 20, 30, we've got one stock we've been in, we've made 66%. And I think we may be getting out of it now, but those are the ones that make up for all the losses that you get along the way. And everybody has losses. To say anybody says they don't, has got a long Pinocchio nose. So Tony, the Sleeping Tiger setup is what we use. I will not explain that today. If you want to check out Tony's Market Club, of course, we'll explain it quite a bit. But this was a recent trade we made. We got into American Airlines, and if you see this, it was on the 11th of April, and we've been in it ever since. We got into American Airlines. I said to enter over 4265. That was this day right here where the green arrows are. And so we got in on this day. I said to put our initial stop at $40.95. So our initial stop was right down here. And I said our initial profit target was 44.20. Well, actually, on the very first day, which is unusual, granted, it happens, American Airlines met our first profit target, and as you can see, that met up with a 50-day moving average right here, which can sometimes act as resistance, although in this case it's moving sideways, so it's moving horizontally. It usually doesn't offer as much resistance. So American Airlines popped up here, fell back down, pulled back a little bit, and then just walked right up a very nice angle here when I captured this chart today. It was trading at $46.48, and we're up about 9% in, what would you say, about two weeks. So we're doing well, and American will announce earnings this week. We tell our members you can stay in through earnings if you want to. There is a risk of losing capital, so I if it's a new trade, I suggest that traders either take their profits before earnings, or if you want to keep a small amount, like keep 100 shares or whatever a small amount is to you, take your profits on most of it so that you're playing with the house's money. But that, of course, is a decision you have to make on your own. We tell you what we think, and then you can do, of course, what you want to do. So this is a review of one of our recent trades. We also, at the same time, got into JetBlue, and JetBlue had basically the same pattern, so basically the same thing happened. It popped up and walked up nicely. I will show you, now I'm going to show you three of our recent trades. Of our not recent trades, I'm going to show you the three trades that we talked about yesterday. First of all, now these haven't really taken off yet. First of all, I want to show you NiSource, symbol NI, Incorporated. Now, we don't trade the big Momo stocks. We don't trade the big high momentum stocks in Tony's Market Club. What we tell you to do is you can trade anything you want. Using the Sleeping Tiger setup, your trades should be more successful as long as you follow the rules. And the rules are easy, but as long as you follow them, you can use the Sleeping Tiger setup to trade Baidu, to trade, we've been in Apple, but to trade Baidu or to trade Amazon or to trade Netflix, you are welcome to do that. We don't usually trade them in Tony's Market Club. Most of our trades are stocks that are priced at $100 or less. Once in a while, we're getting one that's bigger, but most of them are that. We also, I tend to trade, not always, but some of the time, I tend to trade conservative stocks because many times they'll make more money. And of course, if the market is trading at its all-time highs, I do get conservative then, because if the shorts come in or one little thing goes wrong when the market's at its highs, people tend to take profits. And we know, because we are those people, and I am those people, and I will tend to take profits. So I tend to, When the market is at all-time highs like it is now, I tend to get more conservative. Look at it this way, okay? Look at it this way. I would sell some of my and take some profits in some of my high momentum stocks for this reason. If you're standing on the top rung of a ladder, okay? You walked up a ladder, you got to the very top rung, and all of a sudden, a stiff breeze came up, right? You lost your balance and maybe fell down the ladder, which is could be painful. Now, what if you were standing on the first or second rung of that ladder when the stiff breeze came along? You wouldn't have very far to fall at all, right? So when a stiff breeze comes along, like in the next few days or week, if something happens in the market that says, you know what, it could be a geopolitical event, and goodness knows we've got enough of them going on right now, don't we? It could be any little thing. I want the market to prove itself. I want it to make sure it has legs, as we say, that it can keep moving higher here. When we're at all-time highs, I stay a little bit conservative. Now, doesn't mean, I also give you trades that aren't as conservative, but that's what I wanted to say before I say to talk about NiSource, which is a current trade we talked about yesterday. Now, NiSource, and by the way, I go in and look at the fundamentals. I do that for you. I know that most traders would rather eat toothpicks than look at fundamentals. And so I will do that for you. I don't go in very, very deep, but I look at the price to earnings ratio. I look at the dividend. I look at earnings estimates moving forward. I give you the earnings date so you'll know when the earnings are coming out, especially in earnings season. I looked at NiSource yesterday and I liked it. It's an energy holding company. They distribute natural gas They are also an electric utility. Yes, it's conservative, and I know that. I have a couple of more that aren't so conservative. Earnings come out May 3rd. It does, for anybody who wants to keep it as part of their portfolio, pay a dividend of 2.89%, which is sweet in this time of our market. Now, I did say that it closed today at 24. It may not have closed today. I don't know where it closed. I captured this a few minutes ago. When I captured the chart, it was trading at $24.36. I like here how it's walking up the 20-day moving average. I like how the 50-day moving average is scooped underneath. I like the gentle movement up of the 14-day RSI down here. And of course, the MACD, you can't see it, is gently coming up in recent days. There's something else here I like that you may see with me, and that is the volume here. That is the volume. When you see volume coming in and the stock staying or moving slightly higher, that is a good sign. So I said in Tony's Market Club yesterday that if it's something you want to do, you can look at NiSource, symbol NI. You could enter the trade just at or just over $24.37, which would mean it's breaking out of this little short-term consolidation. It's already broken out of the longer term. So $24.37. Your stop would be $23.75 down here. And I'm going to give out the initial profit target as $25.60. At $25.60. It doesn't mean it's going to go there, especially with earnings season. It may not. But you want to have three numbers when you're trading. You want to have a good entry. You want to have your initial protective stop that you will hopefully drag up underneath price if your stock moves higher. And you will want to see where can it go next where it won't hit resistance. Now, the prior high here, it's already gone over. So we're looking for the next one, and I chose $25.60. So that's something you may want to look at. It's up to you. Of course, we do not guarantee our stocks will go higher. I would like to guarantee that, but if we could do that, we'd all be on a yacht in the Mediterranean, wouldn't we? Okay, our next slide, or somewhere equally wonderful. Our next stock that we looked at yesterday is the Altria Group, symbol MO, because of course it used to be Philip Morris. I read an article in the Wall Street Journal over the weekend how cigarette companies, like of course Altria, which is one of the biggest in the country, cigarettes, believe it or not, are actually bringing in big profits now because the prices keep getting raised higher and higher and people pay them. So I'm looking at Altria Group here. It's trading in a consolidation. It moved up to prior highs, up to over $76. Then it pulled back to under the 50-day moving average. Earnings come out May 2nd. It does pay a pretty decent dividend here of 3.41%. Again, in the Altria Group, we have Philip Morris. They also have a U.S. tobacco company, and they have Chateau Saint-Michel, which is a really nice wine, and I didn't realize that was made also by Altria. Also, and this is, I don't remember where I read it, so don't quote me on it, I do believe I heard that these big tobacco companies, cigarette companies, are actually potentially getting into the cannabis trade. So don't quote me on that because I don't remember where I read it. But that might either work out or it might not work out. But I'm looking right here at Altria. It closed at 72.49. It is trading below its 50-day moving average. Because the 50-day moving average is horizontal, I'm thinking that if Altria starts up here, it may be able to easily ride above this 50-day moving average. So it closed at 72.49. I told the Market Club members that they could enter at $72.75. I want it to break out of this consolidation. Our stop here is 71.50, which is tight and right under this consolidation. And our profit target here is 7450. Now that's just where this gap is from back earlier in March. And of course, doesn't mean we get out at the profit target. If the stock is doing well, we just keep pulling up our stop. But it's a potential profit target that certainly is a good place to take profits. Or maybe you want to add to the position at that point, but we have to see how it's doing at that time. Okay, let's go on to, I've got one more trade to show you. It will be after the Thursday update, so hold on. I wanted to tell you quickly about the Thursday update because I don't want everyone to feel like, and this happens within a lot of trading rooms that are only once a week, and I get that. Everybody like, well, great. I've got the stock. Now that I've got it, what do I do with it kind of feeling? And so in order to assuage that so you don't feel like you're stuck out there with nothing to hold on to, every Thursday afternoon, we put out the Thursday update. It is a team effort. Kathleen works on it. Annette Helsper, who is our market research technician and who is in this room with us today. You saw her in the chat box a little while ago. Annette puts a tremendous amount of work into the Thursday update. Then I take it and I put even more hours of work into it, and Tina puts work into it as well. So it is, it comes out every Thursday. It's emailed to you. We give you the current market overview and events. We show you current support and resistance levels on major indices. And the most important part is we show you what to do with your current trades. Take profits here, move your stops to here. I even have a no kidding around stop I use once in a while that means absolutely, positively, don't let your stop fall below this price. Yes, Mom. And so the Thursday update shows you what to do with your current trades, how to manage your risk, and when to take profits. And I'll say, hey, either get out here with a tight stop, take half your profits here, maybe let the rest of them ride, move your stop to here, so you know what to do and you're not just left hanging out there. And I mean, the price of Tony's Market Club is so incredibly reasonable. But I don't want to raise the price because I don't want to put it out of range of people who are kind of new. We do have a member, and you will see this if you go to our page that we'll direct you to. We do have a member that says he makes his money back every month to pay for Tony's Market Club. So it's to him it's free because he can always make the money with his trades to cover the Market Club. And that is my goal for you. That is what I want for you. And I want you to make more than that. So this is the Thursday update. Now I'm going to give you one more trade in just a minute, but first I'm going to hand the microphone to Tina for just a second.
And thank you everyone for joining us today. Please be sure to stay with us as Tony will be back in just a moment with her final trading idea here. So far today you've had a chance to get a brief sneak peek at what we do each week in Tony's private training group called Tony's Market Club. And we'd like for you to join us each week. As always, there are no hidden fees, contracts, or obligations with Tony's Market Club. It truly is a risk-free program. If you're watching the recording of this video, you can click on the orange button that says click here for more information found right below the video. Please take a moment to check us out. In Tony's Market Club, you'll learn how to trade smarter, more safely, and earn more money. So please join us. And as promised, here's Tony with her final trading idea for today. Thank you.
Okay, so this is the last trade I told you I would tell you about. This one has a more momentum to it. This is a stock, an equity called Imperva Incorporated, symbol IMPV, IMPV. And it is a cybersecurity stock. Now let me get my notes on this. Now the earnings come out on May 4th. I'm not sure that I would hold through earnings here. Maybe a teeny, teeny, teeny bit, but not much more. It could jump way up in earnings. It could fall like a stone. This is a cybersecurity stock. It has a negative price to earnings ratio, so that's why I told our Market Club members, we are renting this. We are probably not buying it for a long time. We are probably just going to jump in for any anticipation that traders have that earnings will be good. Cybersecurity stocks, I went through the entire list of them that are in the ETF known as the HACK or the HACK, which is this cybersecurity ETF. I go through those stocks quite a bit. You will notice that they are extremely volatile. Some of them fly high, some of them fall like a stone. Look back here at what Imperva did back here in February. That could have been earnings, I'm not sure, for that time period. They could have been really good, but then look, fall back down. So it's a it's a much more volatile stock than Philip Morris or NiSource, but we want to have something that moves a little bit for our traders. Imperva provides cybersecurity solutions that protect business critical data and applications, whether in the cloud or on the premises and so forth. Again, it's a cybersecurity stock. Most of them don't have good earnings yet. They're having a tough time. A lot of times the black hats win in this business and the white hats don't, but they're trying to do better here. What I see with Imperva, and you can always watch the HACK for a direction here. What I see with Imperva, technically speaking, is that it has fallen down from this big jump up again, which may have been earnings, I'm not sure, down to what almost looks like a head and shoulders pattern. But in this case, head and shoulders, what it can do many times, and everybody doesn't know this, it can act as a continuation pattern instead of a top reversal pattern. And that's a very good thing to know. Also, of course, a top reversal pattern here, Imperva hasn't come up from its low base far enough to be called a top reversal pattern, although it could have fallen here. But instead, this kind of head and shoulders pattern turned into a continuation pattern. Now Imperva has moved up over its 20-day moving average, which is layered below the 50. It's moved up over the 50 and today popped up over the 200-day moving average. Now their earnings come out again on May 4th. Again, I'm not sure that I would stay in through earnings because it would be a highly risky move to do that. It closed today, or it was trading when I captured this chart at 43.45. Now I did tell our members yesterday to buy it over $43.05. It's moved up a little bit since then. If the market continues to remain to move higher, I suspect Imperva can go with it at least for another week or so. If the market rolls over, Imperva may roll over with the market. So you have to know that there is risk here. Our initial stop for the Market Club, and one you may want to use, is $41.94. And that is a no kidding around stop for Imperva, $41.94. At least make whatever stop you use for this play, if you get into it, a no kidding around stop. Initial profit target here I have at 45 as our initial profit target, and if it can go higher, fine, we'll do that. Okay, you all, that is our presentation for today. Let me say one thing to you. There's two ways you can learn how to trade. You can learn how to trade with a proven system, with a proven expert who has your best interests at heart, or you can certainly read books, and Lord knows I've spent a lot of time writing books, and so have other authors that will help you. But if you want a personal touch, again, we can go back to, you can either learn how to trade in a setting like this, or you can advance your trading techniques and your skill set in a place like this, or you can let the market teach you how to do that. And I promise you, from experience in the old days and from teaching thousands and thousands of students, letting the market teach you how to trade can be very, very harmful to your wealth. Besides, it's not good for our stress levels. So please do consider. We'd love to have you. We've got a fantastic group of people. We would love to have you. If you would like to join us, and again, some of our members have been with us for 8 years, and we don't plan on going anywhere soon. So if you do plan to join us, again, and if you want more information, click on Tony's Market Club in this web link box over in the left-hand column, and then click on Browse To, or go to our link here, tonyturner.com/tonys-market-club.com. If you're watching the recording of this, you can click on the orange button that says click here for more information, found right below the video. So we want to let you go now. We've been on for almost an hour. Again, we would love to have you. We are a successful group. We'd like you to be successful, so please check us out. I hope to see you next Monday. Until then, keep green on your screen. Bye for now.
On a warm summer's evening, on a train bound for nowhere, I met up with a gambler. We were both too tired to sleep, so we took turns of staring out the window at the darkness till boredom overtook us. And he began to speak. He said, "Son, I've made a life out of reading people's faces, knowing what the cards were by the way they held their eyes. So if you don't mind my saying, I can see you're out of aces. For a taste of your whiskey, I'll give you some advice." So I handed him my bottle, and he drank down my last swallow. Then he bombed a cigarette and asked me for a light. And the night got deathly quiet, and his face lost all expression. Said, "If you're gonna play the game, boy, you gotta learn to play it right. You got to know when to hold up, know when to fold up, know when to walk away, and know when to run. You never count your money when you're sitting at the table. There'll be time enough for counting when the dealing's done." Every gambler knows that the secret to surviving is knowing what to throw away, knowing what to keep. 'Cause every hand's a winner and every hand's a loser, and the best that you can hope for is to die in your sleep. And when he finished speaking, he turned back toward the window, crushed out a cigarette, faded it off to sleep. And somewhere in the darkness, the gambler, he broke even. But in his final words, I found an ace that I could keep. You got to know when to hold up, know when to fold up, know when to walk away, and know when to run. You never count your money when you're sitting at the table. There'll be time enough to count when the dealing's done. You got to know when to hold up, when to hold up, know when to fold up, know when to walk away, and know when to run. You never count your money when you're sitting at the table. There'll be time enough for counting when the dealing's done. You got to know when to hold up, know